The Lord, praise the Lord. Well, good morning, West Coast Word Church. We're so glad you're here. It's good to be in church. Amen. Amen. Praise God. You know, the Lord has something for each and every one of us this morning. Amen. Spirit of the Lord's really been speaking to my heart about this service and giving me some specific direction and change of direction, even during worship. Worship was outstanding, by the way. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Yes. Praise God. You know, it's important to worship the Lord. The Bible says that praise stills the avenger. When the enemy is trying to take from you and steal from you, praise stills him, stops him in his tracks. Praise is very important for our spiritual life. It's one of the ways we receive the filling of the Holy Spirit when we sing songs and spiritual songs and hymns unto the Lord. Amen? I'm teaching in a series entitled The Filling. I'm specifically talking about the filling of the Holy Spirit, because the filling of the Holy Spirit is a very important part of our life as Christians in our Christian walk. We need the filling of the Holy Spirit. We need Him. We need His filling. When your tank feels empty and low, you particularly need His filling. Amen. And probably everyone in the room has been at a point many times where your tanks felt empty, and you need the filling of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, the ministry person of the Holy Spirit, is so valuable for our life, so important for our lives as believers. And so I want to talk to you this morning about the filling, and that it is the will of God for you to be filled with the Spirit of God. And I want to talk about speaking in tongues, because speaking in tongues has been one of the most misunderstood aspects of your spiritual life by many people, many misconceptions, many wrong teachings, wrong ideas, wrong theories associated with speaking in tongues. And I found that speaking in tongues has been very valuable for my life, not only when times have been really tough, pressure has been on my life. Speaking in tongues has been very valuable, because speaking in tongues does edify a person's spirit. And you need a strong spirit to get through. You need a strong spirit to survive. Okay? But speaking in tongues isn't limited to only tough times. I speak in other tongues and pray in the Spirit during times of great jubilation and joy, because the power of the Holy Spirit is valuable for us when things are good and when things are not so good. Amen? Praise God. Hallelujah. So I'm going to show you some things in Scripture. This teaching that I'm teaching about here has brought out the reality that we can be free and live free. Amen. And how to stay free. Amen. Free from particularly addiction, drug addiction, alcohol addiction, excess, you know, opioids addiction. You know, the devil doesn't want this message going forth. He don't want it going forward. He don't want it going forward because he's held a lot of people in bondage for a lot of years in these areas. And we don't need to be ignorant of his devices. We don't need to be ignorant of the Word of God and how to be free and how to live free. Amen? And so I'm going to ask you to go to Ephesians 5:18, please. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. There's something the Spirit of the Lord is dealing with me, speaking to my heart about this morning. It's very serious. I have had this happen one other time in 18 years of ministry. One other time. And this morning was the second time. So before we go into this, I'm going to deal with it now. This could be for someone in the room. It could be somebody watching online. I don't know. That doesn't matter. What matters is the Spirit of the Lord knows, and He knows what's going on. If it's not you, it's fine. But pray for who this is for. We're a body of Christ. And here it is. someone has been contemplating murder, murdering another individual. The thoughts have come to murder someone. And you've been contemplating on how to go about it. And one of the methods and ways that you've considered doing is using a vehicle to run them over. And the Spirit of the Lord is reading your mail. Again, you could be watching online and telling you that is not the answer. You do not want to do that. And His help is available for you. There's also an individual who has been considering suicide. It's two different people. The thoughts have come of suicide. Pressure has been on your life. Things have happened. And you've thought in your mind, I would be better off dead. And a recent event has even tried to push you even further toward death. And God would say that He has given you and made available to you life, and life more abundantly. And that is not the best answer or solution for your life. And He's asking you to choose life. It's your decision, but to choose life. And to choose life so you and your seed can live. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Heavenly Father, I come to you in the name of Jesus, the name that is above every other name. And Lord, I thank you for your Holy Spirit, for your ministry and help of your Holy Spirit to give insight, wisdom, and understanding. And I pray for those individuals now who perhaps are in this room or maybe not. Maybe they're watching online. But as your Holy Spirit has gone forward and ministered and spoke through me and led me to say those things, I pray for the peace of God that passes all understanding to fill their heart and their mind. And that their heart would no longer be troubled by demonic influences and forces, but that they would be free by the Son of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Free. Free from those thoughts of death and suicide and murder. Free in the name of Jesus. No longer to entertain those thoughts. And that their life would flourish. That their life would grow up in the things of God. And they would no longer be influenced by those dark demonic thoughts, but that they would be influencers to others about and of the light of Jesus Christ. And there would be a great change, like a 180-degree change in their life from this day forward. And that you would help them with that change. And Lord, now as we're here to receive of your word, this message about the filling of the Holy Spirit, I pray that our hearts are open to hear and to receive of you. And in areas of our life where we've been ignorant, confused, frustrated, irritated, distracted, mistaught, misled, I pray that there is great clarity by the power of the Holy Spirit in this morning, in this place, in the hearts and lives of every person here. And if there's anyone in this room that has never received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, the Lord of their life, that they would not leave this building without making that firm decision in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Just give Him praise now. Hallelujah. Just raise your hands. Just give Him praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for your truth. Thank you for ministering to us. Thank you for meeting our needs. Thank you, Lord, that you care about us. Thank you, Lord. You satisfy every need. You answer every question. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for ministering to our souls, our minds, our will, and our emotions. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah. Ephesians 5:18, let's look at this again. It says, and be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, right? But be filled with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. Say that with me. Be filled with the Spirit. Now, the New Living Translation says, don't be drunk with wine because it'll ruin your life. Instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Say instead. Now, this isn't a coincidence. This isn't an accident that the Bible talks about being drunk with excess of wine or alcohol. You just say alcohol. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. That's not a coincidence. It is very purposeful that the Holy Spirit would inspire these writings to us through the Apostle Paul, showing to us and revealing to us that instead of being drunk with alcohol, a person can be filled with the Spirit of God. And over the last 2 weeks, we've looked at how there is a relationship, there is a parallel, if you will, of the effect that alcohol can have on a person's life and the effect of the Holy Spirit on a person's life. But the Holy Spirit never causes damage to our life in any way, shape, or form. The effect of the Holy Spirit and the infilling of the Holy Spirit is always to give us life and abundantly. Amen. Amen. And so what we're learning, we've heard that we're not supposed to be that drink and have excess of alcohol in our lives. Most people have heard that. Not everybody, but a lot of people have heard that. But what we haven't learned is, what do we substitute it with? If we have this urge, this craving, this desire to relax, to take the edge off, to sort of get away from it all and escape, sort of, you know, get out of yourself. Okay, well, I saw that alcohol did that, or drugs or opiates or whatever else, but what else? If I'm not supposed to do that stuff, what am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to be satisfied? How am I supposed to get through life, so to speak? And I'm here to teach you that it is the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And you could sit there and say, I don't know about all that. Well, guess what? I've never drank alcohol. And I could sit here and take the same attitude about alcohol and go, I don't think alcohol really does that to you, because I've never tried it. I don't truly know that it actually does that to a person for myself. I don't have personal experience in that. And you could sit there and go, what do you mean? If you drink a six-pack, something's going to happen. And I could go, I don't believe it. And you could sit there and say, I don't believe the Holy Spirit has that kind of effect on a person's life. And you'd be wrong, and I'd be wrong. And I can confidently tell you that the infilling of the Holy Spirit can have one of those most amazing effects on a person's life. And this person's life, it has had that effect over and over and over again. And in my life, personally, I have zero desire for anything other than God's very best for my life. And I'm not going to settle for any counterfeit and any weak substitute for what the Spirit of the Lord has already ordained and given for me, for my life, to have the effect on my life like these other cheap substitutes try to do. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'm going to read it again. Don't be drunk with wine, because it'll ruin your life. Instead, say instead, be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, we looked in the book of Acts, and we won't have to go through this in great depth, but we see here that after the Holy Spirit came into that upper room, we saw as they were leaving, the onlookers and the ongoers were looking at the people that were leaving this place. that had been speaking in other tongues, and it looked as if they were intoxicated, if you will, as if they were drunk. And we see here in verse 14, Peter says, make no mistake about it. These people are not drunk, as some of you are assuming. He said, it's 9 o'clock in the morning. It's way too early for that. He said, no, what you are seeing was predicted a long time ago by the prophet. In the last days, God said, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. I will pour out my spirit upon how many people?
All
flesh. Not just a couple, not just a few. His spirit is poured out upon all flesh. God's pouring out, but are you doing the drinking? Are you receiving of him? Or are you busy trying to fill your life with fake substitutes? Hallelujah. Now listen, I'm not preaching this message for personal gain. I'm not preaching this message because it's the most popular message in church today. In fact, it'd probably be hard to find a church that would preach a message like this. I am preaching this message for one reason, because the Spirit of the Lord has prompted me to do this. And he's been preparing my heart for about 2 years to preach this message. Glory to God. You see, here's how I look at it. If a person doesn't know what the will of God is, then it's incumbent upon you to find out. And if you want to know what the will of God is concerning these things, then it's up to you to find out. Because it's not okay for you and I to be ignorant of God's will for our life. And if something like alcohol and drugs is not God's very best for your life, then it's up to us to find out what is. Amen? Because God has placed resources in the earth for us to know his will on these things. And those resources are the Bible, right? God has worked through and with the Holy Spirit, giving inspiration to men and women who this came about, their lives. And God saw to it that here in 2018, we still have Bibles. Amen. We have documentation of God's word from thousands of years ago. Hallelujah. The Bible is one of the greatest resources in the earth today for humanity to know the will of God. It is. We've also been given the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, I will go and send one who is greater than me. And he is the Holy Spirit. And he not only will be with you, but he will be in you. In you. Hallelujah. And he goes on to talk about who the Holy Spirit, the person of the Holy Spirit, what he will do for your life. He says he will lead you. He will guide you. He'll comfort you. Amen. So we see these resources, and we have the fivefold ministry. Hallelujah. And it's as described in the book of, where's that described? Ephesians, right? He says, and now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church, right? The apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors, and the teachers. And he says, their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. I think it's so important that people that are in ministry aren't in ministry because they thought it was a cute idea, or they because someone else in their family did it, so they're going to do it. I believe, personally, that people that are in ministry should be called by God to be in ministry. Not because they filled out a form on career day and said, you should be a pastor. I don't even think that's possible, but I don't know. Why? Because this is not about Let me say it like this. This is a kingdom calling. It is kingdom business. The kingdom of God. And God is who sets these people in positions to teach and to lead and guide. But it says their responsibility is to equip God's people to do the work and build up the church, the body of Christ. It is very important that we build one another up and encourage one another. Amen? And if you're going through a tough time, we need to look for those who are going through tough times. We need to pray for those who are going through tough times. Because we've all faced some tough times, and we're not done facing tough times. We need each other. Amen. And so if we go through life never knowing the will of God, then it's very easy for us to be deceived. And I'll say this, we've all been deceived in our life. There's areas of our life where we've all been deceived. None of us know it all. None of us have it all figured out and have had it all figured out from the very beginning. No, we're all growing and learning and in the understanding of God's word and how it works and the will of God for our life. But I will say this, it's not okay just to stay ignorant, because Satan has built his entire kingdom on the ignorance of people. Hallelujah. Hosea 4:6 says that my people perish for a lack of knowledge, because they have rejected knowledge. Well, we don't want to reject the knowledge of God's word. We don't want to reject the voice of the Holy Spirit in our life. Amen? Hallelujah. Go with me back to, well, thank you, Jesus. You know, if you think about it, I'm going to add this point in here, that Christians, believers, if there weren't believers in the world, this place would be in an awful heap of trouble. The Bible talks about in Thessalonians that the church is holding back the evil. It says that in a particular portion of Scripture that there is lawlessness. And that this lawlessness is being held back. That which is holding it back is the church. There is coming a day, whether it's in our lifetime or not, we do not know. But there is coming a day where there'll be a catching away of the church, the believers. And in that day, this lawlessness, this evil will be revealed on a whole nother level of evil. You hear people say things like, oh man, it's bad. I'm not saying it's great, but when the church is caught away, you're going to see a whole new level of bad. You're going to see a whole new level of evil unleashed on this earth like the earth's never seen. So, God wants us saved. He doesn't want us experiencing that kind of evil. And there's evil in there. I mean, there's some garbage going on. The devil is on a rampage. I mean, he's got his modus operandi is to kill, to steal, and to destroy. And I really do truly believe that the days are short. I mean, I talked about this on a Thursday a few weeks ago. Jesus is coming soon. I say that not because I've heard that said. I have heard that said. But we say that, and I showed you in Scripture at least 3 places in Scripture where it tells us Jesus is coming soon. And you say, well, he's coming soon. This book was written 2,000 years ago. Ha, ha, ha. I guess he's not coming soon. Oh, he's coming soon. Because when you understand God's timetable and you look at our life compared to the expanse of eternity, a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as a day. So if you live to 120 years old, it's like 4 hours in heaven, the whole 120 years. So in God's mind and in his way he thinks, because God created time, but he's not in time. And when he tells us he's coming soon, people. Amen. Amen. You know that coming soon has helped me. It's helped me. It's helped me a lot. It's helped me more than I ever thought it would ever help me, the scripture about he's coming soon. Because I begin to just look at life, not with lesser value, but just as such a shorter, brief time on this planet. And it helps you get your priorities right. Things that meant so much to you before suddenly don't mean quite as much to you because you go, hey, Jesus is coming soon. You know, you just look at those of you have, you know, that you just watch children just grow so fast, you know. And you look at this and you go, man, it just seemed like yesterday I met my wife and we were dating and, you know, and here we are 20 plus 5 years later. Glory to God, you know. And you just go, wow, this life, you know, it's not all cracked up to be what people want to make it to be. It's very valuable, isn't it? It's very important. Our life is very important. And what I'm saying is don't waste your days on things that don't matter. You don't need to be in a drunk, drugged stupor one day of your life. Because your days are precious. Take full advantage of what God has given you. And when you feel like you need to get away from things, turn to the Holy Spirit. And let him fill you. And let him minister to you. And let him bring you to a place that you didn't know you could even go in him. Amen? Let me get back on this, what I'm teaching on here. Actually, I want to read this. 1 Timothy 2:1, gentlemen, New Living Translation. He says, I urge you, first of all, to pray for all people. Ask God to help them, intercede on their behalf, and give thanks for them. Pray this way for kings and all who are in authority, so that we can live a peaceable and quiet lives marked by godliness and dignity. This is good and pleasing and pleases God our Savior. God our Savior, look at this, who wants everyone to be saved. How many people does he want saved? He wants everyone to be saved. But look at that. It doesn't end there. And, say and. And to understand the truth. Satan lurks in ignorance. And he deceives thousands of people, millions of people. He has been deceiving people for thousands of years. But God wants you saved, and he wants you to understand the truth. He doesn't want you ignorant of his will. He wants you saved and understand the truth. Well, God's word is truth. God's word is God's will. We don't have to sit here and scratch our head like a monkey and go, I don't know. He wants us to understand the truth. Amen? Now, this teaching on the filling is bringing out the truth about some very particular things I've said, as such as drugs and alcohol abuse and use. And the Lord is revealing is that drugs and alcohol don't need to be depended on to get relief or to relax or to get your mind off of things. I keep repeating this because I want to really drive this point home. This is the whole purpose of the subject that I'm teaching on here, is understanding you don't have to settle for those things, but that there is something to replace that with, the original Holy Spirit. Amen. And it's not wrong to want to relax. It's not wrong to want to have something to take your mind off of things and to get away, so to speak. What is important to know is what to depend on. And what, more important, more exactly, who to depend on and who to go to. And the best way to keep out what you don't want in is to be filled with what you do want. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, back to Ephesians, because I want to read this in a few translations here. We read King James says, don't be drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. The Message translation we read last week says, drink the Spirit of God, huge draughts of Him. Say that with me. Drink the Spirit of God, huge draughts of Him. The Complete Jewish Bible says, don't get drunk with wine because it makes you lose control. Instead, keep on being filled with the Spirit. That means you keep going back to Him. You keep going back to Him. And it goes on, it says, sing psalms, hymns, spiritual songs to each other, sing to the Lord and make music in your heart to Him. Amplified Bible says, do not get drunk with wine, for it is a debauchery, but ever be filled and stimulated with the Holy Spirit. Say stimulated. Now, notice, again, I'm just repeating this a little bit, but that the Holy Spirit is telling us to keep on being filled, ever be filled, because God is ever ready for us to receive of Him. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you can always receive of Him. He is pouring out His Spirit upon all flesh, constantly a pouring out, and being filled with the Spirit can be and should be literally a way of life for us. It's a constantly receiving of Him. And it can be, it's for anyone who is willing to receive and believe Him. And it's the will of God for us to be filled again and again and again and again, day after day after day after day. You know, I have friends and people I know in my life who started out drinking sort of recreationally or socially. And I've noticed over the years that urge, that desire to drink socially came to a point that I noticed they were drinking every night. It was like their day at work began to revolve around the focus of getting home and beginning to consume alcohol to take that edge off. And then I've noticed some people that I know in my own life that not only was it every night, now they're doing it earlier in the day, and earlier in the day, and earlier in the day, to the point that alcohol began to consume their life. You ever heard of anybody like that? I think everyone in the room has. I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit is available for us morning, noon, and night. And we can literally develop a thirst for Him. That we can go to Him. And we can be satisfied by Him. And don't sit here and think it doesn't work, because it works. I'm the one who has partaken. I can confidently preach this to you because I've received of Him in this manner, in this capacity. And there are times in my life where I haven't, where I've just gotten busy and all this stuff. I can sense it, and I can sense the pressure of life and the things of life coming on. And then, man, if you let your mind go, all kinds of crazy thoughts and ideas will spring up. But thank God I've been taught better. Thank God I've partaken of Him. And thank God I know I can go to Him and receive of Him. And I can begin praying in the Spirit. And I can feel, I can literally feel and sense the presence of God filling my heart, filling my life. And He brings satisfaction to me. I'm telling you, I'm preaching this not from an idea that's a good idea, from experience in this area. Hallelujah. It's been such a blessing to my life. Dominic, will you come up here, please? Thank you, Jesus. I asked Dr. Dominic, he's our utility minister. He writes for us, he preaches for us, he teaches, he leads worship for us. You and your family are a blessing to our life. You've been a great blessing to this ministry. And it's such a blessing to see you as a young man so hungry for God and to see no compromise in you. I like to surround myself with people who do not compromise. That's a blessing. And I've asked him to share his testimony. I don't think I've fully heard your testimony. I've heard parts of it, so I'm actually very excited to hear this. But I see your passion, I see your hunger for the Lord, I see your fire in you, and I want him to share his testimony. Please, glory to God.
Thank you, Pastor. How many people are excited about this series? I'll tell you what, I'm so thankful. Thank you for being led of the Spirit to minister on this. I want to just give you the Reader's Digest of my testimony, hit the bullet points, and I just want to leave you with two scriptures that have really helped me along the path of when I grew up in Maryland, and where I grew up, it was a very rural part, so there was not a lot to do. It's funny, I think pastors mentioned about Kansas City in the morning, about how there's nothing to do out there, so that's probably why people get into bad tendencies and so forth. But when I grew up in a good home. My parents definitely took care of my sister and I, but the one thing, they were big-time partiers, like super big-time, like to the point where when I was in elementary school, if, you know, my parents were having a party or whatever, you know, they'd be like, hey, Tess, you know, try this, you know, shot of vodka or whatever. Like, I remember being a really young kid and getting exposed to alcohol very early, not even really wanting to, just kind of curiosity or whatever. So by the time I was in middle school, you know, I was smoking weed before anybody even gave me a cigarette, just because it was easy to get to. You know, there people were selling it, people's big brothers had it, so forth. So at a very young age, I was exposed to a lot of different drugs. So by the time I got to high school, I was hooked on cocaine, experienced, you know, any type of drug I could get my hands on. And, it, you know, peer pressure was a part of it. But as Pastor was talking about, I just wanted to get high. I mean, that was the bottom line. I just wanted to escape, wanted to do something fun. And one thing I want to throw into the testimony that's so powerful is I grew up Catholic as well, and growing up Catholic, one of the things that just, you know, it was just always whenever you sin, you would go to a confessional booth and tell the priest, you know, I kicked my sister in the leg or something like that, and you would just have to, you know, confess. And at whenever you would confess, the priest would say, well, you know, go and say five Hail Marys, say a couple Our Fathers. And I was young, but I was like, this is stupid. I was like, this makes no sense that I would say a couple prayers and God would forgive me. And I, that's literally my take. And I remember that when I would go pray, I would say, Lord, I would even tell him, I was like, Lord, I don't know if I can just outright speak to you, but I think this is stupid. And, you know, my parents, they're partying. And they were, as I grew up, the partying got worse and worse. And my parents started getting, not physical, but it was verbally abusive to each other. They would, you know, be nice to us, but it was very obvious that they were, it was really bad in the house, and it was getting to the point of divorce. And I remember I would pray. And I didn't even know if God was real. And I would just pray, God, if you can save my parents' marriage, then I'll know you're real. And that was my prayer. And years went by, and I was doing drugs, cocaine, and my mom, she went to a meeting that somebody invited her to, and they were teaching on the anointing. And what a weird subject for somebody that's only known about Catholicism, you know, to go to a meeting and hear about the anointing. And I remember, and I shared this last time I was ministering, but when my mother went to this meeting, she came home, and I was stoned with my friends. Like, we were just, you know, out of our minds. And my mom walked into the room And she said, I met Jesus tonight. I said, great. That's awesome. And I'm just like, totally like, what, you know, and she actually said, touch my hand because something's different about me. And I just thought she lost her mind. And what even happened was that my dad's like, your mom's gone crazy. I'm leaving her. And I'm, you know, I'm in high school. I'm like, yeah, she does sound like she's gone crazy. She made us go to a church service that was, you know, 2 hours long or something. And so we went and, you know, it was a very charismatic church and so forth. And but with the drugs going on, I didn't realize that God was answering my prayer because I was so far in deception. And I didn't even, you know, I didn't know anything about it. And then my mom tricked my dad into going to this conference to save their marriage. She said it was like this nice conference. She left out a detail that it was a, you know, a Holy Ghost believing conference. So my dad goes and the first night he's like, when we get home, I'm leaving you. I'm leaving you. And when they went to sleep that night, slept in different beds and everything, the Lord spoke to him in his dream. And he said, when you wake up, you're going to forgive your wife and you're going to follow me and you're going to be a man of God to your family. He woke up and was at my mom's bedside, says, the Lord spoke to me. And he gave his life to the Lord. They came home. I'm still, you know, partying, going hard, making up, you know, and they come home and they're like, we're going to start going to church. We're going to start serving the Lord. And I'm like, great. Well, I'm almost 18, so do whatever you want. And then they had a charge in their heart to move to Florida. We were in Maryland. And I did not want to go. It was my senior year. And when you're a senior, you're like, you want to party with your friends till the end. And I was like, I'm not going. I almost got my grandfather to, you know, get me to stay because I was almost 18. And Holy Ghost knows what he's doing. So I came to Florida with my parents. And then we found this church. Everybody was like, you got to check this laughing church out. And I was like, what the heck is going on? I was like, what is wrong with my family? I was like, you know, first off, we're going to two-hour services, and then we go to the river. And if you don't know anything about the river, 2 hours is light. 2 hours, that's nothing. You think church is long here, you don't even know. And when we go to this service, we went to the river, and Pastor Rodney Howard Brown, who is, he's already in history books for revival, if you don't know. He's a great man of God. Definitely check him out. And we went there, and my mom said, after we went to this meeting, I was like, well, I'm glad that's over 5 hours later. We're, you know, I hope we never come back. Because all people, it was a camp meeting, so literally the pastor walked back and forth. And as pastor's talking about experiencing the presence of God, people were getting carried out of the building. That's how drunk they were in the spirit. And people could be weirded out by that, but when you can get drunk on the Holy Ghost, it is not made up. It is, and so I thought it was crazy. And, you know, if you don't know anything about it, it does seem crazy. But when after all that took place, my mom signed me up for Bible college there. And I'm like, you did what? And I was not excited at all about it. And I would actually go to Bible college. They coerced me into it because they were going to pay for some things if I went. I was like, fine, I'll go. And I used to go to Bible college high on cocaine, which is like completely stupid, completely ridiculous. And I would go, and the thing that I want you guys to know, and I've even said this to people, some people say, you know, could you talk to somebody for me, or could you let them know about, you know, what they could do to know God more? And I said, I can do that, but you know what they need? They need an encounter. I can talk till I'm blue in the face about who God is, but until you experience him for yourself, I can, and pastor, he can get up here and he can preach the best sermon. The anointing can be all over the place, but you have to make a decision. You know, a pool could be sitting right there, but until you jump in, you're not getting wet. And I'm here to tell you that hell is real. And I know sometimes we don't hear that word very often, but hell is real, and addiction is a path leading you right down. You know, some people, and you know, I know people have different doctrines and stuff, but you know, when people say, once saved, always saved, and you know, I want you to know, don't ever live a life that tests that statement. Because if you do, then I would question your salvation. And addiction leads you right down that path. 1 Peter 5 talks about be sober. You know how people talk about alcohol being liquid courage? It's liquid deception. I don't care if you have one drink. I don't care whatever it is. I don't touch it anymore. And I know that even after I got set free, when I would go back to hang out with friends thinking I was going to minister to them, by the end of the week, I was back doing the same thing. You have to make a decision that what it is in your life. And I remember when I went to the Bible college and I kept doing it, the thing that put me over was encountering God. And I kept going to school high and high, but there was people around me and the anointing was so strong. When you keep putting yourself in a place willingly, the devil gets uncomfortable. The devil of addiction, it's a spirit. You have to realize addiction is not a bad habit, it's a spirit. And it has to be dealt with. And the anointing is the only thing that breaks the yoke of bondage. And Jesus is the anointed one. You need an encounter with Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit reveals Jesus to us. And that's why the Holy Spirit is so vital to our lives. And that's why you have, if you're struggling with any addiction, there is not a 10-step program. There is a one step to giving your life to Jesus. Don't be confused by all the different things. And I know that some people think there's different. I'm telling you, it only takes one encounter. But the thing that stabilizes that is that relationship and a willingness to surround yourself, to be accountable. I have people in my life that I had to, you know, I was struggling with this. I need you to text me a scripture a week or, you know, whatever. Get people around you, a support system. But you need an encounter is what you need. And that's what sets you free. So that's my testimony in a nutshell. And I'm so excited about this teaching, but I really challenge you that an addiction, yes, it can, and you know, to go even further, it's not just alcohol and drugs, like we're saying. You could be addicted to Netflix. You could be addicted to the computer, addicted to your phone. So don't just, and I know Pastor brought this up, but you know, all those things are stealing away your potential, your time, and the things that God has for you. I mean, how many people in the room have been affected by somebody that was in a drunk driving accident or somebody that, you know, I've had friends that I, and even my closest cousin have died of heroin overdose, people that I was hanging around with and stuff, and I'm tired of it. You know, we got to do something about it. And we can't just keep saying, you know, it just runs in the family or things like that. We got to stand up. This is our city. This is our town. Let's break the spirit of it off. But we got to stand up for it. We got to do something. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Would you lead us?
Amen.
In prayer? Stand to your feet, please. You that also?
Hallelujah.
However you desire. Hallelujah. Okay. Thank you, Jesus.
Well, as Pastor was ministering on the baptism of the Holy Spirit and speaking in other tongues, the biggest thing that we have to understand is that there is not a greater gift. And I believe Pastor read it in the first service. He may have read it in this service as well. But when it says that the Father has, he wants to give us the greatest gift, in Luke it talks about that the gift of the Holy Spirit is literally the greatest gift that he can give. And if you have not received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Holy Spirit, and I want to challenge you right now, you know, because you gotta have that in your life, that accountability, that fellowship and that relationship. So if we could, it's very simple. Sometimes it's not complicated. God wouldn't make receiving a gift complicated. That would be like, you know, trying to give your kid a gift, but sticking the gifts on the roof, saying, you know, grab a ladder, you know, you go get, you know, the gifts are right there for the taking. Amen. So if we could just close our eyes and lift our hands as a sign of surrender, let God know that you're willing. Hallelujah. Just repeat this after me. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I receive that gift that you purchased for me at the cross. And through your resurrection, you have brought the great outpouring of the Holy Spirit. I receive that gift of the Holy Spirit. He is now my best friend, my greatest accountability partner. I surrender to his leading, and I am thankful that you are a good God that gives the best gifts. In Jesus' mighty name, Amen. I want you to continue to lift your hands, and I just want you to start praising God. And that's what it talks about when we speak in tongues, that we're just edifying, we're praising God. And as you praise God, I want you to just be willing to just move your mouth, allow words to come forth, and a spiritual language is going to birth out of you as you praise God. But you got to speak. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Mo kule shitelele, kile shitelele, bros no kule shitelele, kile shitelele, let it come out. Oh, we thank you, Lord. Mo kule shitelele, kile shitelele, bros no kule shitelele, kile 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 shitelele, kile. Mo kule shitelele. Oh, we stir it up, Lord. We stir it up. We stir it up. Oh Lord, mokule shitelele, kile shitelele, shitelele. Hallelujah, mokule shitelele, kile shitelele, kile shitelele, shitelele, shitelele. Bros no kule shitelele, kile shitelele. Oh Lord, we thank you for Tarpon Springs right now, Lord. We thank you that the spirit of addiction is gonna run because this church is coming. In the name of Jesus, we break the spirit of people overdosing. We break the spirit of heroin. We break the spirit of cocaine off this city, off the surrounding cities. Lord, we thank you that our families are being set free right now as we are lifting up our praises to you, Lord. We thank you. We thank you that we are going to continue to populate heaven, Lord. Father, I thank you. I thank you that school systems are going to start recognizing the name of Jesus again in this area, Lord. Mokule shit. I thank you for high schoolers. I thank you for college kids getting on fire for the things of God and being unashamed to preach that gospel. Mokule shitelele, kile shitelele, kile shitelele, kile shitelele. Oh, we're not messing around, Father. Here we are. Send us, Lord. Mokule shitelele, kile shitelele, kile shitelele, kile shitelele, shitelele, kile
shitelele. You are welcome here. You are welcome here. Oh, Holy Spirit, you welcome here.
what your life will look like if you begin to walk this way. You're wondering what your peers will think of you. You're wondering even what some of your family members will think of you. You're trying to sort of envision yourself looking like this. Like if I'm a Christian and if I really am, and I really kind of go out on a limb like this, you know, what will it change? What will it look like? Well, the Bible says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. Let me tell you something. I may not be the coolest guy in the room, but all through high school, college, I was an athlete. I didn't compromise in this area of my life. I even went to a Bible college for a little bit. I got more picked on at the Bible college than I did in secular college because of how I believed, and because I believed in the infilling of the Holy Spirit. It's not for wimps. It's not for cowards. It's for men and women, young people who are willing to stand for what is right and receive what is right. And I tell you what, this non-compromise in my life, and I'm saying I've been perfect with it, by no means, but this lack of, because I haven't compromised in my life, God has blessed my life. He's brought in people into my life that I never thought I would ever meet, opportunities that I never thought I'd ever have. When you seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, His way of doing and being right, all these things are added to you. There's a man that did some of the most amazing things that I've seen in my generation by the name of Oral Roberts. This guy was on television when there was only like two or three channels, preaching the gospel, laying hands on people, talking about the Holy Spirit. This guy built a university all with the help of the Lord, but he didn't compromise in his faith. And he said this statement. He said, "What you compromise to keep, you'll eventually lose." That statement stuck with me and will stay with me my entire life. When you try to compromise and live your life apart from how God, you know the word says live this way, but you're going to compromise because you want to hold on to this part of your life, you'll eventually lose it. But when you don't compromise and you live according to what God says, you'll gain. You'll gain. 100-fold now in this time, the Bible says. Prayer couples, if you'd come forward at this time. If you're here and maybe you didn't receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior yet, something you desire, or you need prayer in an area of your life, we're up here to pray with you, believe God with you. It's maybe a completely different church service, but guess what? Dominic, is your life better?
Absolutely. 100 times.
100 times better. 100 times better. I don't know a cocaine addict that's on cocaine right now that says their life's 100 times better. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise the Lord. Lord, thank you for these people. Thank you for their heart, their willingness to stay here and to hear and to receive of you. Lord, I haven't forgotten, and I know you haven't either, about those two people that we opened up the service with addressing. I know your heart is for them. And Lord, your heart is for everyone in the room. And right now, Lord, I just pray right now over Nick and Jennifer in the name of Jesus. I just stretch my hand out. You guys don't know what's going on. It's all right. Just pray for this couple here in our church. Lord, I just pray right now for you to continue to minister to them, to undergird them, to help them, to bond them, to strengthen them. That your love would envelop them and keep them in the hours, in the days, in the weeks and months and years to come. And that your mercy and your grace would carry them through every moment and every time of struggle. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. You're the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, blessed going in and blessed going out. And everything that you set your hand to, you're the lender, not the borrower. You're good looking. You're dismissed. God bless you. Thank you, Jesus.
Death cannot hold you, the veil torn before you. Silence the bones of sin and grave. heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever, God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom, yours is the glory, you are the name above all names. What a powerful name it is, what a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is, and nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. A powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Oh, death could not hold you, fell torn before you. Silence the boast, sin of the grave, God. Heavens, I'm roaring, the praise of your glory. For you are raised to life again. Yeah. You have no rival, you have no equal, now and forever. God, you reign. Yours is the kingdom and the glory. You are a name above all names. What a powerful name it is. A powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. Powerful name it is, nothing compares to this. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. Thank you.
Spirit of Jesus, living within us. Never to fail or forsake. Unending promise. Heaven inside us. Whispers the sound of your name.
Like a child become run.